of the Google for this Hindi translation, and also online some of my students and my colleagues are available, or any one of you. Also, at times I'll be seeking your help. You help me in translating that, and to the best of my knowledge and understanding, I'll try to clarify the queries in the context of the presentation. To begin with, who are these differently abled learners, and what is inclusive education? And in the second half of it, as I told, we are going to discuss the policy perspective of NPE 2020, that is in the light of National Policy of Education 2020. So, agla taraf se seekhe hue logo matlab kya hai? Aur samabhavi shiksha, inclusive education, iska matlab kya hai? And what is NPE 2020? Iska baare mein bol rahe. Aage hamare ko kya karne ka hai ye area mein. All right, this is what we are going to see. I hope you are able to see my presentation. Somebody confirm me, we'll go ahead. Great. That's great. Thank you. So, who are differently abled? Alag tarah se seekhe hue logo kaun hai? Historically, in our classroom, as a teacher, you and I have been knowledge and working experience of that all learners do not learn alike. It's true, all of your class students will be learning, but all of them are not learning alike. And whose latest version is none of them are learning in the same way. That's what draws our attention to individual differences. That's what invite us to look at IEP, Inclusive Education Plan, or Individualized Education Program. And some of you, those of you have some experience with special education or integrated education aspects, I'm sure immediately you'll be recollecting, oh, wo jo vikalango nahi to, the other differently abled or disabled related we are talking. No, we are not talking about just differently abled means disabled. Pehla main to ye clear bolna chahta hu ek baat ki alag tarah se seekhne wala bacche matlab viklang or differently abled or disabled is not. It includes them, but it is not just limited to them. So then who are differently abled learners? Most of the definitions come from different point of view. Somebody define them from the point of view of learning, abhyas ke, difference ke taraf se. Somebody from physical abilities, somebody from IQ basis, and so on and so forth. But combining all those definitions, probably this is what I understand. The differently abled learners is children, those who deviate from normal or average in abilities, interests, learning needs are known as children with different learning needs are differently abled learners. So who are these alag tarah se seekhe huye bache? For a long time we have been thinking that who differ in their learning needs or achievement levels, abilities. Your 40% uske piche andar wale, 40 to 60 the average bache, or above 60, above 70 the bright, genius, gifted bache. But a comprehensive definition of differently abled does not refer only to their learning needs. Please look at that. Those who deviate from normal or average abilities, interests and learning needs. It's not just unka learning ki differences, unka interest ka difference. Shraddha kaha hai uska? Interest kaha hai? Uska abilities, capacities of what? That deviate from normal or average. Now, if we literally take this, your classroom average is 50% or 55% achievement, and then 45 to 55 is average. Above 55% deviate from that average. Below 45% achieved students also differ from that average. That's how the traditionally for a long years we have been thinking. But now the latest is, are these 45 to 55% achievers learn alike? Are their abilities one and the same? Aren't there the difference in their interests as well? So I'm sure we all agree, even those 45 to 55% average marks achieved students also differ in their abilities, in their interests. So therefore, it is unique abilities. And the latest concept is every individual is unique, and hence each learner is different. So therefore, everybody is a differently abled learners. Otherwise, typically what comes to in our mind, the moment we say differently abled learners, some picture of this particular kind. Those who are physically challenged, mentally challenged, visual or hearing challenges they are facing. So therefore, the important question before we progress, we need to address and understand is inclusive education or differently abled is limited to physically challenged? Yeah, ye shasharirak aur manasik roop mein aksham ya divyangajan ke limited hai kya? Does differently abled or inclusive education is limited to physically challenged? I'm sure you all agree with me. No, definitely not. If that is the case, you don't require a word called inclusive education. Already you have that existing in the name of special education, education of the disabled, IED, inclusive, integrated, inclusive education for disabled, or the integrated education. So therefore, first to understand is differently abled learners includes, no doubt, the mentally challenged, manasik divyangajan, physically challenged, sharirak divyangajan, academically backward, those who are achieving low, gifted or creative, even they are also considered as differently abled because they are learning in a different manner when you compare to the other. Probably when the teacher trying to explain the third time or a second time, some student in your class feels like, how long this story teacher tells? Does he or she is going to go ahead today? Are the same old record is going to be repeated? Who are those? Those gifted are creative. On the other hand, this academically backward has requested, sir, why don't you go a little slow? Why don't you repeat a second time? Is it compulsory as a part of our syllabus or otherwise I must learn? Apart from that, we also have socially disadvantaged. SC, ST, BC, for a long period we have thought, but at least thanks to constitutional amendment, now we are not just looking at only a caste. It is socially disadvantaged, goes beyond that to include all those children have a disadvantageous learning environment. So therefore, socially disadvantaged, learning disabled. Now, probably we are all familiar with this academically backward. Jo fail hote bache sab subject mein maximum to 30 mark, 40 mark leke aana bahut takleef hai. We call them academically backward. We are all familiar with them. But we also interestingly come across some children who get 50, 60, 70, even 80 marks in other subjects, but hardly get a pass mark in one or two subjects. For example, the mathematics, English, Hindi, Telugu, social. It is not just limited to math and English, though most common in South Indian context. It is mathematics and English. Then what do you call? Is definitely not academically backward, because the other areas of academics is par excellent, average or above average. And there is no obvious physically challenged or mentally challenged. And then their family background, if you look at the kind of school they are studying, is also okay, fine, at least. If not excellent, par excellent, definitely average, above average facilities are there. Then why? So those children have specific area-based problems, technically called as learning disabled or learning difficulties. Then finally, multiple challenges. Those who have more than one of these areas. So before we move forward, let's see quickly who are all those differently abled learners. You could see here a beautiful classroom, which contains your regular children, normal children, physically, mentally, divyangajan, the differently abled or the challenged. So therefore, differently abled learners are, note that they are not limited to different categories of disabled children only. It covers a wide range of children, from physical, intellectual, social, emotional, educational spectrums. So therefore, it includes, no doubt it includes your sharirak or manasik divyangajan, but inclusive education or the term differently abled learners is not limited to only these two or three categories. It encompasses physical intellectual challenges as well as social, emotional, educational, etc. spectrum, the range of challenges. All right. So then who are those? All that comes under this differently abled learners. Earlier, if you see the old literature, particularly prior to 2000, you will find this term called special needs children or disabled children, which includes the medical perspective, those who are suffering from prolonged diseases because of the severe disease or prolonged period of treatment and cure required, they are not able to join. Similarly, those who have the behavioral problems in classroom, you'll find some one or two or three children for a class who neither sits calm nor allow others to concentrate on the ongoing class. Behavioral problems. Developmental issues. Same age, is in 8th class, 13 years old, but doesn't understand algebraic expression. Then the learning challenged or learning disabilities or difficulties, then mental health. And considering all this, the broad categories, interestingly, also include these. When you talk about those social, emotional challenged, it also includes the following. So therefore, now differently abled, alag tarah se seekhne bachche includes not only sharirak manasik divyangajan, but also all these categories. For example, street children, orphans, child labor, delinquents, children under armed conflict, migrated and refugees, prolonged diseases, physically challenged, of course, mentally challenged as well included, multiple challenged or disadvantaged from various perspectives. So in order to understand now, if you look from this broader perspective, and if you also examine the NPE 2020, even that goes beyond these categories. It includes physically, mentally challenged. it includes all these socially, economically, emotionally, behaviorally challenged. Also, it talks about the gender inequality. Minorities, including linguistic minorities, religious minorities, whatever the cause. And they face the challenges in learning context. So before we move forward, let's see briefly what are these, some of the important categories to think inclusive education is for, are the differently abled, which is not just limited to physical and mental challenged, includes the street children, sadak par rahne wale bachche. Now, especially in your urban areas, particularly the metropolitan cities, very common phenomena. You'll find children in the streets. Now, your RTE, according to Right to Education Act, every child has a right, 6 to 14 years. And of which right now? It is a fundamental right. Now, because they did not come to school, so they remain illiterate. You can't say that now. That entails you have deprived the right of some citizens. Are these street children citizens of India? Undoubtedly, yes. Then when all children means, does these children are not included? Definitely included in the term called all children as defined by law, or otherwise the concept of inclusive education, or otherwise your UEE, universalization of elementary education. Sabka vikas sabke saath. Kaise ho jayega, suppose if you leave these children. So therefore it's high time to think on this point of view. Look at the way where they are staying. Railway station platforms, abandoned houses, or the old vehicles. Now, therefore, there is a new program under your Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan earlier, the Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan. We have sheltered homes for these children. Now, someone has to identify them, put there. Then you are giving them the education, but not inclusive education. Please note that. Therefore, the aim of all these sheltered homes, alternative school arrangements, is to integrate them and finally include them in the normal regular classroom. Fortunately, somebody adopts them, and such a child with such background comes to your class. And then in the name of inclusive education, if you say, I'll treat everybody equal. No doubt equality is important, but what about equity? When you treat everybody on par with, equality is assured, taken care. But what about equity? If that is the case, our government schools are already inclusive. Never they rejected any child. Anybody comes, they were saying, you're welcome, come. Either you are a dropout from other school, whether you are a dropout for the reason of failure, whether you are never enrolled, still you are in 11 years, 10 years, till the government schools welcome them. Yeah, equality we have been for a long time as a constitutional guaranteed right have been following even in education, in spite of several inequities yet to be addressed. Therefore, now it is high time to think about, is without including these children in our main fold of education, does our system becomes truly inclusive? Orphans, anathe. You have several orphanage homes where you keep them, and of course, if you educate there, again, is a segregated approach. Historically, if you look in the evolution of inclusive education, first phase, particularly before 1980s, 1970s, it was the segregated approach. You keep all orphans in one, all street children somewhere else, and all those physically challenged, hearing challenged in a blind school, all mentally challenged in some other shelter kind of center where they are rehabilitated. That is the segregated approach. At least after 1970s, with the 1976 Government of India, IED, Integrated Education for the Disabled, and other initiatives, we have brought them to the main school. Half of the school or the few classes are given along with the other children. And for few other classes, you take them to separate training. For example, the visually challenged for Braille, hearing challenge for speech and language therapy, locomotor challenge for their physiotherapy, mentally challenged for their special task analysis or daily life skills training, that kind, which was called integrated. It's good, something is better than nothing from that perspective. At least from outside the village, you have brought them to the peripheral of the village. Sometimes they can get along with the villagers and still they have to live separately. That kind of. But what is the problem with this integrated? No doubt it has got its own advantages. Even for that matter, segregated approach also has got its own advantage. Specialized training, particularly vocational training, the best possible coaching was given for different categories of Divyangajan, differently abled or disabled in those days, as we call them. But the limitation is social deviation, social segregation. Now, after this education and vocational training, where should they live? Do you have a separate visually challenged world, locomotor challenged world, hearing challenged world, and normal people society? No, we have only one society, one world, one country, one community. So there they have to live. So therefore, with that social skills development, making them a part of social life on par with the others, the integrated initiatives have begun in 1970s and 80s. Up till 2000, we have been in various forms implementing that. But that also after 2000 particularly, much of their child rights, human rights, are violated because of the discrimination. So the defining term of inclusive education is non-discriminatory, which we are going to discuss further, but we will see some more categories of these differently abled children. Child labor, balashram, delinquent children, nazuk bachche, children knowingly or unknowingly might have committed some offense, which is punishable as per IPC Indian Penal Code. Or there are also other children in the age of your 6 to 18 years who don't know the whereabouts, parents. They have run away from the homes. Now they don't know, or they don't want to go home, therefore escaping. And finally, police or some NGO has found them. They don't know their home address also. Literally, they don't know. Let's say 6 years, 7 years. And all that he knows is he just got a train in his hometown, and that train brought him to Mumbai. There he took the other train, and that brought him to Hyderabad. Now he is caught by the police or NGO, service organization. And when they try to find out their whereabouts, he don't know, and above that, he don't want to go back home. Then what do you do? Such children who are known as children in need of care and protection. Please note that, unfortunately, one negative tagline attached to juveniles or the juvenile children is, or the delinquent children is, as if they have committed crime. Not necessarily. There are two categories who have committed some or the other offense, which is punishable under IPC. There are children who are in need of care and protection. Now, without including all these children, our education for all is not complete. Right to education is not given to all citizens. Similarly, children under armed conflict. Now, for last 1 year, we all have been experiencing a different kind of unseen enemy-based war-like situations. But physically, literally, especially the border states, once a while, at least twice or thrice in a year in some of the areas, they do face this kind of situation where they can't go to school. And it's not safe. Send the children, at the same time they can't keep at the home for a longer period. They are also worried about their learning, education and all those things. Then migrated and refugees is again another problem. When parents migrate from one district to other district, one state to other state particularly, one region to other region, or in the border states, refugees, neither the other country, Bangladesh, is ready to accept them, nor because they are not the Indian citizens, and we are also not ready to accept them. Whether anybody accept them or not, are they children or not? Yes, they are children. Do they deserve childhood? Yes. Is education a part of their growth and development? Undoubtedly. So therefore, how to meet their educational needs? Prolonged diseases, for example, the cancer, HIV, or even children not infected by HIV. Parents are infected by HIV. Though children are known that they are free from HIV or AIDS infection, accepting them in the normal, regular schools is a great challenge. Once accepted, also the kind of mindset they have, the kind of guidance and counseling needs they do have. Unless we are sensitive and provide that, it's not going to be complete. All right. And then, of course, along with all these, definitely well known, one of the by numbers and already identified and in the school system, in our larger education system existing, are the physically challenged. Sharirak Roop Me Divyangajan. Now, we all are aware that you also have Olympic level, Special Olympics. And their performance shows that they are truly differently abled. There are certain challenges to be overcome. So therefore, the next aspect is, so what is there in the name of inclusive education for all these children? Before we move that, just give me 1 minute. Somebody from the organizers, you want me to shift to the next one, or is that okay? I continue here. This is okay. We will go ahead with this. Thank you for that confirmation. If should there arises a need, please let me know. That's fine. I can shift over. Okay. All right. Let's go ahead. Now, so what is inclusive education? Before I go ahead with this concept, whatever we have discussed so far, I invite you, are there any questions, queries, clarifications, and so on and so forth. Yes, please.
Sir, my chat box mein dekh raha hu, kafi questions aaye hain.
Very good. Okay, let me look at the chat box once. All right. Sir, as you have been going through this, would you like to tell me one or two which you want me to address at this stage and which we can take at the end of the session or this first session? Otherwise, here I see what is the difference between inclusive education and integrated education. All right. So I'll be addressing this. Meanwhile, I request the organizers to go through. It seems there are quite a good number of queries, and anyone you want to draw my attention or you want me to address right away, please let me know. I'll be answering this. Yes. The difference between inclusive education and integrated education is, inclusive is non-discriminatory. That doesn't mean integrated is discriminatory. Please don't misunderstand that way. Inclusive is based on non-discriminatory. Integrated is based on providing the educational facilities to the children for a part of the time together with others and other part of the time separately. For example, if you have a visually challenged, hearing challenged children in your regular classroom, integrated education implements this way. Up to afternoon, 4 periods, 5 periods, classes are combined. Last 2 or 3 periods, classes are divided, where normal children will continue in this main class, hearing challenge will go to some other speech therapy or a sign language class, and visually challenged go to Braille or mobility training, that kind of class. Now, to give you further clarity, what happens in the name of inclusive education? Yes. Inclusive also provides these services, but not discrimination based like this. It is need based, interest based, as far as possible in the same classroom. But definitely one challenging task is, does it practically possible as well as feasible? कर सकते अगर कर सकते भी करने का मीनिंग है क्या योर ब्रेली ट्रेनिंग योर स्पीच थेरेपी एंड ऑल दैट इन दैट रेगुलर क्लासरूम नो इट विल बी देयर बट इट वोंट से हेलो यू आर विजुअली चैलेंज्ड यू गो टू ब्रेली क्लास इट विल नॉट ही सेज नो आई डोंट वांट गो टू आई विल सिट इन द रेगुलर मेन स्ट्रीम आई विल रिकॉर्ड एंड आई विल लिसन बैक एंड दैट्स इट एंड इट वोंट कंपेल. So therefore, it is not discriminating, but it provides for the needs of every learner, provided the learner wanted to make use the facility. He don't want to make use that facility, he still can cope up without the facility, that's okay. If it is integrated, no choice. You are visually challenged, you go to this class. So that kind of dividing the people, which is based for the discrimination. Non-acceptable based on your human rights, child rights, is there in integrated education, whereas inclusive, it calls additional supportive services are provided. Now to make use them, not to make use them, is the option of the child. If you feel like I am discriminated by going that way, he wanted to stay with the regular normal class and continue, still encouraged. All right. Anyway, we'll be discussing further on this as we go through. The next subtopic we are going to discuss is inclusive. Hope you will get further clarity there. All right. Madhurima Mukherjee. Okay. We can integrate all type of children in an inclusive classroom. If we include in an classroom a couple of normal children, visual challenge, street children, delinquent, then what about the classroom climate? I want to know in the light of inclusive classroom, kindly let me know. Right, Madhurima, most pertinent question. And this is a challenge ahead of us. Each one of us as classroom teachers and teacher educators are going to, because now the Right to Education Act, National Curriculum Framework, Disabilities Rights and Provisions Act, and the Policy Perspective of NEP 2020, all those are in this direction called inclusive, which is not an option, rather is order of the day. Now, if different kinds of children are there in one class, what the kind of challenge the teacher is going to face and how to manage such a class definitely is a challenging but also inspiring, for which we both mentally, physically and educational resource wise need to prepare. But only the point is, only after such ultra infrastructure is prepared, then we are going to implement. No, that's not the option we have. only after everybody has got at least two wheeler or four wheeler, then we will think about aeroplanes. That was never the kind of development goes ahead. So therefore, even today you have bullock carts going on the roads. Even rickshaw wala, the auto rickshaw, the other rickshaw are there, and you have your trains, and also we are planning for bullet trains. You have your aeroplanes going, flying, and also we are planning for supersonic planes. So therefore, whatever the little way you and I as a teacher can implement, let us start. There is a long way to go to meet the needs of all these children in the same regular classroom without any discrimination, as the true spirit of inclusive education. To my knowledge, in Indian context, we have one particular building which for several years has been meeting these individual differences. For example, your parliament. When the parliament session is going on, everybody wearing their headphones, listening in their choice of language. Somebody listening in English, somebody in Telugu, somebody in Hindi, Gujarati, Marathi, Tamil, Kannada, whatnot. All Indian languages. Maybe if we talk idealistically, if our classrooms are equipped with such facility, where visually challenged, hearing challenged, all can continue in the class, probably live over 2030, even 2050 is also not an ideal year to think about. So therefore, what the challenge and opportunity came in front of us, to which we all have to raise and begin to meet within our own possible limitations, is to include all these children. By and large, they will be getting learning along with. What is required to begin with as a classroom practitioner, you and I, to concentrate is to provide some additional guidance, additional support, additional provision. If you were using a chart till yesterday, can you think of embossed chart, which your visually challenged child also can touch and feel that? If you are using a PPT like this, till yesterday, till my last presentation, it is only in English. And today, in with all my limitations, I try to make it a bilingual, at least for headings to begin. If I have to give it next time, even I will have my bullet points also. By fifth time, probably you can understand what it can do. So in this way, let's think, make up our minds, and to begin to include the linguistically differently abled, the physically, mentally, socially, emotionally. Only thing is, off the record, I'll say, on record, legally, it is not permitted, but severely challenged even today, of course, our classroom cannot accommodate or cannot do anything. Leave about academic side, even the social benefit also, they are not going to get benefit. So probably maybe, because even today the special institutions exist parallelly along with your normal regular classes. So let only severely challenged be off the record, prepared, not educated, not continued, prepared to get integrated, then included. Prepared to get integrated, then included. By that time, those teachers also will come back to us, where they are going to serve as resource teachers or consultants for the other teachers. All right. I hope that addresses a partial of the query. All right. Atanu Roy, I have a question. He says, normal MED and special MED same ya nahi? Aur samagra siksha abhiyan mein kya kya include kiya hai? All right. Earlier, normal is meant for your normal DEd and BEd colleges requirement as far as MEd is concerned, and special MEd is for special BEd and special MEd, like we have BEd HI, BEd MR, BEd VI, and BEd multiple challenges, so on and so forth. But now in the coming days, it is going to be like this. Both are the same. One indication as on today you have is, in our own state, Telugu states, particularly Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, even otherwise, the special BEd were not eligible for your regular state government recruited jobs. And now they are given on par with any other regular BEd. The special BEds are also equally treated and eligible to be recruited as a regular normal teacher, which is a good sign and indication that we are going to put all teachers and all students in the same mainstream. So therefore, it was different, but in the coming days, it is going to be same. Both are meant to serve all the children. Yes, if somebody has a query.
Sir, actually now, currently, I'm Deepika, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
New batch. Sir, actually now BEd is there for special education also, no, sir?
Even now also course is being run.
Yeah. So as you are saying is, there is, in future it will not be like that, separate BEd.
No, course will continue, people will get trained, but earlier regular BEds are for regular schools, special BEds are for special schools. In the coming days, regular and special BEds will join the same school called your normal regular inclusive school. Both are eligible to meet the needs of all the children. Got the point?
Okay, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
And one thing also, sir, like actually as a teacher, student teacher now, and you being a lecturer now, actually, I would like to share this, that mostly in abroad countries, the teachers, those who have done the normal BEd are not much applicable. Instead, they are going for the special educators only. They are giving much focus on the special educators only. Is it that true, sir?
Yeah, the point what my knowledge and experience goes is, abroad there is a lot of demand for these specially trained children because people from their local community, there I heard, especially in the US context, in
yes,
most
sir.
Of the counties called your villages, remote places, these schools are going to be, where the local citizens are not going to prefer or to work in those areas. So therefore, there is a strong depth and need for people working in special education area in the remote areas. So that's the reason they are preferring from other countries, particularly from India. People are doing very well. The second reason, once our people go there, they are doing very well, committed service in meeting the needs of these children, and therefore. And the second thing is, as a context has come, let me mention that particularly developed several European countries, even severely challenged, will have a seat. The one who cannot sit in the classroom will come in his wheelchair and will have a seat in regular normal classroom. Even the cerebral palsy child, who is not going to get any benefit of that particular classroom transaction called in academic terms, still will be given an admission. That's an idealistic state. Probably it may take some time for us to reach there, but nothing wrong. A humble, good beginning will be starting and will be going towards.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Right. As I go through the chat box, if you have any queries, you can ask somebody who is online.
Sir, Anamika Singh's question is.
Yes, please.
What kind of challenges are faced by teachers who teach in inclusive classroom?
All right. Rather, I love your question to be call as what kind of challenges and opportunities teachers have in inclusive classroom. We do have challenge and also we have an opportunity. Earlier, as a teacher, any point of time, a teacher is a teacher of whole class. But for lack of this inclusive commitment, most of the teachers served as teachers of a majority of the class. And if there are one or two children also, many a times, because of our limitation or it's not our commitment, we could not really do the needful for them. And now the opportunity is, yes, to include all the children. But definitely the challenge is, if I concentrate on these children, what happens to the other children? The most common challenge. In the name of inclusive, nobody recommends to concentrate on and neglect some other. The spirit of the concept of inclusive is individual needs. Of course, if you are giving a little more attention to a particular child based on his need and interest and requirement, not that because he is mentally challenged, physically challenged, socially challenged, emotionally challenged. He is a learner with unique characteristics, different learning ability. So therefore, as a sensitive teacher to meet the learning needs of all my classroom children, this child needs some more time. That child needs permission to write his answers in his mother tongue. Third child needs, because he can't write, to record his answer and present a verbal format of it. Fourth child is not good at writing an essay, but is very good at art and drawing. He would like to represent that in the form of art and present his project acceptable. But the next question comes here is our curriculum oriented that? Is our evaluation system that flexible? It is yet to be, but we are in that direction. Earlier, any formative test or summative test is essay questions, short answer questions. That's it. At the most, with some multiple choice or the objective type questions. And now your formative assessment, definitely for that, it will 25 marks. What all it has? Written work, oral work, participation in the classroom, project, and sudden surprise test. At least we made a good beginning, and of course, still a longer way. If some visually challenged child, instead of a scribe, if he says, no, I just want to give my responses orally, please do take. Honestly, today our system is not prepared, or we don't have the norms to accept that. But yes, it is high time to think in that way, so that you are permitting him and you are making the truly inclusive. So therefore, both our curriculum, evaluation system, classroom transaction needs to be more flexible, adaptable. That's where the challenge comes. And as individual teacher, what we can do, let us begin a humble beginning from our end and expect from the systemic side, these reforms and flexibility do follow in due course. Right.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, we have observed that in the classrooms, usually they say it inclusive. Only one teacher will be handling, but the rule is to have one teacher who is subject teacher, and along with that, one inclusive specialized teacher should be there. This is what is not being practiced, what I have seen, sir. Is it a good practice or a wrong one? Can you just clarify, sir?
All right. Now the point is, it is ideal if you could have, instead of one teacher, one regular teacher and one supportive teacher. But the practical reality is, we are struggling even today to have one teacher for one class. Still, some of our primary schools are run with three teachers, four teachers, where primary classes are, you have 1 to 5. High schools also less than 10 teachers, 1 to 10 classes, but only 6 to 8 teachers are there. Under such circumstances, probably that's really a practical limitation, but ideally, if we can have a 2 teachers in any class and every class, and from inclusive perspective, if one regular normal trained teacher and a second teacher who is specially trained teacher who can understand the needs of differently able learners better. That's only a utopian idealistic. When practically one teacher for one class itself is, we have a scarcity, expecting 2 teachers per class is practically not going to possible. So therefore, what I recommend in this context, our policy recommendations also says, is as you could see now in the pre-service teacher training programs, all B.Ed, D.Ed, M.Ed, inclusive education is a topic general for everybody and also elective and also general paper. Some way or the other, everybody is oriented. So therefore, future it is going to be like this. All working teachers will be given either short-term training, orientation, workshop, in-service teacher empowerment program with under different names, are going to be given an orientation to understand and to be sensitive and to meet the challenges of inclusive education. So let us mentally prepare for that. And but aspire to begin with what I say is, in some of the forum of discussion I was suggesting, can we think of, in true spirit of implementing inclusive education, you depute those special schools teachers, children you include the normal schools, special teachers you bring, and they may serve 6 to 8 schools, or at least 5 to 6 schools a week. Every day they go to one school, but they are not directly teaching the children. But the regular classroom teachers facing challenges will be discussed with these specialized trained teachers, and this teacher will help them how to meet their special needs, and then they implement. And the next week when they come, there is one technical name for this program known as itinerary teacher. On a weekly basis, he'll be visiting once in a week and discussing with the teachers, regular normal teachers. Otherwise, if special teacher goes and teach those 3 or 4 specially challenged children, again it is going to be integrated, or again the discrimination is going to come. Hey, your teacher has come, you go, you people. That kind of will come. So therefore, if these teachers can support the regular normal school teachers in identifying, assessing, or meeting their needs, could be an ideal to begin with as on today. All right. So with this, let us consider the first part, and first discussion also is done. And before I move on to the second part, if there are any 1 or 2 more queries, I can take up, and then we will be going ahead. Meanwhile, let me check the chat box.
Sir, Sambhu sir ka ek question hai ki, in what way gender inclusion fund mentioned in NEP can be utilized?
Could you please repeat it once again?
Yes, sir. Yeah. In what way gender inclusion fund mentioned in NEP can be utilized?
All right. So anyway, I'm going to come to that point, but to make a brief mention, it is meant to reduce the gender inequality and to empower the girl children, particularly for their educational facilities, research on gender inequity, ending gender discrimination, reducing gender inequity. All right. Yes, shall we move on to the second half of the session? Are any more questions at this stage? All right, I understand it's time to move on to the second half of this, the inclusive education and NPE policy perspective. So what is the inclusive education? Here you could see this is a kind of emblem kind of thing that talks about the reduce or end the divide, okay, cross the divide. And in this context, I recollect one cartoon sometime back I have seen. It seems on a particular day there was a heavy snowfall, and that school has got both steps and also ramp. And the school attender was clearing the steps first, because majority normal children, so they can go in. After that, he can clear the ramp, and the minority are a few special needs children are there who can go later into the class. And one of these child have asked that person requesting, can you clear this first? Obviously, he asked the question, my priority is majority first. Then he said, yes, that majority only, your 30 children can go, we 10 will be waiting. But if you clear this, we 40, the majority will go inside, total majority. So that's a small step which helps us to cross the divide. So therefore, that's what the inclusive education recommends. Same normal regular classroom where you have your regular children, along with them your special children, both physically challenged, socially, emotionally, linguistically, gender, or whatever, the way they are different or they have a different learning ability. So yeah, you could see what all the groups of children can learn together without any discrimination. For example, in that context, one of the challenge, what is the challenge? For example, a dropout child, a girl children of this age, you look here, all these children are about 8 to 10 years age. Now they are never enrolled. And these never enrolled children, in the name of inclusive education, all of a sudden, you also, I'm sure, aware under RTE, Right to Education Act, they ought to be admitted in age-appropriate class. Because they are around 8 to 11 years age in between, they ought to be admitted anywhere 3rd to 5th class. But a never enrolled child, all of a sudden, admitted in the 3rd or 4th or 5th class, you can understand the kind of difficulty they face. Therefore, we have an alternate arrangement known as bridge course.
Yes, sir.
Non-residential bridge schools and residential bridge courses. These both are attached to various government schools under Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan, now earlier started under Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan scheme. Prepare them. Here their curriculum will be not the class wise, rather first to third level. One particular book will be there, which these age children, for a 5+ years child, it takes 1 year to complete first year curriculum. But the children of this age, they can cope up with in 3 months, 4 months, or at the most 6 to 8 months. By the end of this year, they go and join the age appropriate class. And that's how they are integrated first. From outside the school, they are brought into the school, but attached bridge course. And within few months, anywhere 3 months to 9 months, max by one academic year, they are prepared for their age appropriate class and admitted and continue full time in their normal regular classroom along with other learners. Bridge course, for example, is an intervention. Now, what is the aim of bridge course? Is not segregating them, preparing them for inclusion. Similarly, you have Bhavita centers, particularly under again Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, they have started now under Samagra Siksha Abhiyan. The physically, mentally challenged children are trained and they are included in the normal regular classroom. To give the clarity of the ultimate aim of putting them separately, not to say they are segregated, they will be admitted in the regular school, but they will be taking their classes for some period of time in the Inclusive Education Resource Center. Technically, the Bhavita centers in Telugu states, they are called otherwise Inclusive Education Resource Centers, IERCs. They are prepared there to get along with the all other children. All right. Here I have the source for which I have taken basic information and modified for the purpose of our presentation. Now, apart from this, as far as NPE is concerned, I have another slide prepared for that, which with the help of which we will go ahead now further. All right. Yes.
Sir, I have a query, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, regarding, as you said, the bridge course, na? So do we have a separate school like in Sarva Siksha Abhiyan in government school? And there's a special classrooms maintained. It's a small doubt.
Yeah. Bridge schools, either residential and non-residential modes are available. But where are they available? I'll share my experience from the Telugu states background, and someone online can be shared from the other states what's happening there. In this locality, for example, in Hyderabad, for example, my location of Dilshukh Nagar is a large area, and nearby there is one government school and junior college. In the same premises, you have a bridge school. And Kachiguda railway station, some of you might have heard, apart from Secunderabad railway station, a second and a third railway station is Kachiguda. In that area, there is one Kachiguda government high school. Attached to that, you have a girls' residential bridge school. Like this, there are 15, 20 residential bridge course and non-residential bridge course where these children are trained. So they have a separate centers, but attached within the working within the premises of the regular government high schools. Okay. Now, similar or different experiences from other states, I invite my friends and colleagues who are online can share your experience in this regard. All right. So here I have my presentation related to NPE 2020, but all this is not the context. So I straight away go to this particular thing. Anyway, somebody has asked about gender. If possible, I'll touch it on a little later. But now straight away, let me go to this. Yes. Focus on socio-economically disadvantaged groups. SEDGs. There is one session in NPE 2020 which focuses on socio-economically disadvantaged groups. So I would like to draw your attention here. It just did not say socially disadvantaged. This was the word till now we have been using. Socially disadvantaged. Immediately our brain and mind goes to SCST BC. Now it talks about socio-economically disadvantaged groups. So it's not just caste or community based. Several other categories are covered under this. This particular term called socio-economically disadvantaged groups. What are all those groups under this? SEDGs can be broadly categorized based on gender identities, particularly female and transgender individuals. For a long time, we all know what is happening with the girl child education, female education in the higher education sector. So therefore, but per se, when I mentioned this, all girls, no. Even when we said differently abled was defined, all those who deviate from the average and require special educational support facility. Similarly, when we say female or girl, not all girl child. There are girl children, there are women who are on par with the boys, treated, having facilities and provisions. But when we are talking about this, is those females, those girls and those women who are deprived for either social or economic reasons.
And sir, couldn't see the PPT, sir. Sorry to disturb you.
Yeah, yeah, fine. It's not shared?
No, no sir.
Yeah, just thank you for reminding me that. And right away, I'll share it now. Okay. I'm sure you are able to see this now. Focus on socio-economically disadvantaged groups.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So with this particular name, I was drawing your attention is it did not, NPE interestingly did not set only like earlier policy documents or the other documents, socially disadvantaged. That was the common word we used to use where it refers to a CST, BCE kind of only categories. But now socio-economically disadvantaged group is the term used. Not only this term, you see the categories under that what all are covered. Gender identities, particularly female and transgender. Here you could see the two categories under this again, female and transgender. Female doesn't mean not all girls and women, as I was explaining. It is those girls and women who are deprived of their education for either social or economic reasons. And transgender, at least for a long time, neglected, at least recently, two good things have happened. Earlier, gender means male-female, but at least male-female and transgender are don't want to mention. Those kind of options, you could see the research tools and so on so. Apart from that, inclusion of mother name in the certificate. All right. So kind of things are coming up with this gender identity sensitivity. Now in the classroom, what? As a teacher, yes, this is what we need to do. Some girl child has facing challenges. Can we think of what their challenge? Can we give them some sort of guidance, additional guidance? Emotional support, moral support to begin with. Similarly, socio-cultural identities such as SC, ST, OBC and minorities. Earlier SC, ST, OBC, that's it. Now you also have cultural, socio as well as cultural minorities, particularly the linguistic minorities, religious minorities. They have the cultural differences a lot. To cope up with that, it takes time. Can we understand that? If your school has some cultural practice wherein this particular minority group's faith doesn't approve that. Now we have seen the issues to go to Supreme Court and get that order to say that not singing the national anthem is not a disrespect to the constitutional values. I'm not saying one should not happy, invite, encourage. But if not, can't we understand that? So similarly, if some of your school celebrations, you are celebrating a festival, let us say. We also say as per the new curriculum, local festivals have to be celebrated. So what is the local festival in Hyderabad? Definitely Bonalu. And some culturally different child says, no, this is not our custom. My parents said, I'm not going to participate. How are you as a teacher going to take it? Challenge, prestige, understand, and also make them to understand. This is a cultural practice. You need not follow any of the worship practices of this. But if you don't mind, would you like to be present on that day? Can we invite them, involve them in that way rather than saying, no, if you want to continue in this school, you should follow this. Now, if that is the case, how many religions are there? How many festivals are there? Are we going to celebrate all that? Practically not possible, not feasible also. But yes, major religions, 3-4 festivals you take, you do celebrate and involve and invite all. If some particular religious or cultural group doesn't feel like comfortable, let them. Let's see that where my school understands, my teacher understands. Because now we said inclusive, everybody was invited. If somebody is not comfortable with something, can we think from that point of view? Can we give that leverage to respect their perspective also? Which can solve a larger social problems in future. Why social tensions based on caste, religion, region, language, so on and so forth? Because we haven't sensitized our own children at school level. Either we neglected or we compelled. The most two common ways how in these kind of deviations we were dealing with them. So can we think of that? Geographical identities such as students from villages, small towns and aspirational districts. If a tribal student is there in your class, for example, recently one student in my class was asking, sir, I can't write in English your assignment. If you don't mind, can I write it in Urdu? At least Hindi kuch to samajh sakte. Sir, Urdu I don't understand except like Chinese or other symbols. But you know what did I say? You're most welcome. You write down that. But can you do me a favor? While evaluating your assignment, I'll call you. You read that and translate the same in Hindi for me. Can you do this favor? He said, happily, no problem, sir. But in Hindi, writing also a problem for me. But I'll write comfortably in Urdu and translate that for you in Hindi, orally. And you can listen and then you can evaluate. Now, for this, if I have to sit, let my own college and my university give directions and instructions, then I am going to include this child. Otherwise, no. Now the challenge and opportunity for teachers when somebody asked the question, what I'm referring is this. It is a challenge for me who doesn't know Urdu at all to evaluate a Urdu assignment, but an opportunity for me to include a Urdu student on par with other students, because others, those who want to write in Telugu, Hindi, English, all the three languages, I am permitting. Now why should I restrict this child who would like to write in Urdu? And yesterday when I was discussing with the organizers, I was saying the same thing. They have requested me, can you please go ahead with the bilingual English and Hindi? I said, I love to do so, but let me honestly admit, presentation part, I'm comfortable in English. But questions, let them ask in any of their mother tongue. Now, if any of you would you like to test me, other than Telugu, Hindi, English, you ask in other language, I'm going to address that. Let's try it a little later, but you are welcome anytime of your choice. All right. Geographical identities and disabilities, of course, differently abled is the acceptable word. Otherwise, in our literature and documents, still we are using this. But as per the PWD Act 95 and its revised edition of 2005 and 2020. Differently abled or in the word is acceptable terminology, including learning disabilities.
Ramya, please mute yourself.
And socio-economic conditions. Yes, somebody, if you would like to ask a question, fine. You unmute and you can ask a question. After that, I'll go ahead with this. Or just randomly it was open, please mute it. Socio-economic conditions such as migrant communities, low income households, children in vulnerable situations, victims are children of victims of trafficking, orphans including child beggars in urban areas and the urban poor. Could you see under this and combining all this, almost all categories which we have discussed as belonging to differently abled learner are covered? So from policy perspective, NPE, apart from several other things, has a broader perspective of inclusive. It's not just limited to your physically, mentally, or socially, economically challenged children. It includes the gender identities, socio-cultural identities, geographical identities, differently abled, the disabilities, including learning disabilities, socio-economic conditions, which encompasses all these. And the policy has mentioned like this, you could see the bottom line. Separate strategies will be formulated for focused attention for reducing each of the category-wise gaps in school education. Gap due to gender, socio-cultural identities, geographical identities, disabilities, or other socio-economic conditions. The implementation plan is going to talk about, recently it has come out, very specifically, what are the strategies under each of these. Then we will see a few of those categories which are already mentioned under CWSN. Another category, as such mentioned, is supporting children with special needs, CWSN. Regular schooling, children with special needs will be integrated in the regular schooling process from elementary to higher education levels. This is the perspective of NPE 2020 as far as this. It's not looking to put them in a separate schools. Special schools are special centers or special classes. Which is, though word used here is integrated, but it is the inclusive perspective. Then you also have number one here, enabling mechanisms. Enabling mechanisms for CWSN are Divyang to receive quality education. Now, what are these enabling mechanisms? For example, your text translators. If somebody is visually challenged, till now, Braille. So how much of Braille books are available, accessible? All they are the challenges. But now you have text readers. So therefore, many of, with the help of such kind of software, visually challenged are comfortably able to use the computer like this, as you and I use. Even the mobile phones in our day-to-day experience, they are using. The only thing is you and I are seeing and pressing the options. They will have a voice version. So that is an enabling mechanism for visually challenged who can successfully use your mobile phone or computer, laptop, etc. All right. And then the third, assistive devices and orientation to parents. Technology-enabled assistive devices, tool for CWSN and orientation of the tools, devices for parents and caregivers. Now, somebody was raising one pertinent doubt a little while ago. How if some visually challenged, hearing challenged, and different categories of children are in my class? Yes. So there, what are you going to do? If you are going to use the PowerPoint like this, you are not going to give only the audio and video. You are going to include some more pictures also, so that everybody gets benefited. And in addition to that, as a supportive service or assistive device, for visually challenged, we are going to provide this software called text to audio. For hearing challenged, they can't hear, but they could see this, and you are going to provide them some other, if the hearing aid is useful, partially challenged, you provide them. They are assistive devices. Or somebody with the help of speech training can properly learn language, overcome the language difficulties. For them, we are going to provide that. Also, it has a provision for modules. NIOS, National Institute of Open Schooling, will develop high quality modules to teach Indian Sign Language. Another assistive device for one more category of differently abled. Alternative schools. Alternative forms of schools will be encouraged to preserve the alternative pedagogical styles. Now, for example, in our discussion previously, we have seen the bridge course. Similarly, you know, you have a migrated shelter schools. For example, in our locality, particularly during this summer, parents will come in the month of February for the brick clean work, bricks, sand bricks and earth bricks manufacturing. They'll come in the month of February and they will go in the month by the end of May or June. Or July, definitely. June mid, definitely they'll leave. But actually in their rural areas or otherwise in the state of Telangana, academic year ends with the March end or April. February is the high season of completing syllabus, March and April exams. Just before the exams, and parents migrate, along with them the children will come. Because these 2 months they are missing, 3 months they are missing the school, they were not promoted to the next class and they have to retain in the same class. The good old story I'm talking about. But recent years under Sarvashiksha Abhiyan then and now under Samagrashiksha Abhiyan, we have brick clean schools at the work site only. Temporarily for these 3 months, we'll have a small school setup. All these children will be educated and they'll continue their education here. And again, they go back and they get to the promoted to the next class. Similarly, in Jammu and Kashmir, I haven't seen, but I have seen on internet and other pictures, you have boat schools. Children who would not go to your regular schools on landline, and the boat schools are available. And similar initiatives for migrated labor and orphan children, HIV affected children. All these initiatives are there. They are integrated to bring them back. From there, we need to move another step ahead, inclusion to normal, regular school. First, bring them, prepare them under these alternative schools, and then include them in the normal, regular school. Similarly, certificate courses for pre-service and in-service teachers to become special educators. So now there was a question, what about the special B.Ed., M.Ed. and normal B.Ed., M.Ed.? What is going to happen? Yes. Now, to begin with, we are going to have a certificate course in special needs children. Those regular B.Eds. Who obtain this certificate course, who complete this certificate course, are treated as on par with the special B.Eds. And they are ready to serve as resource persons to meet the differently abled children needs. Similarly, this special B.Ed. done to student teachers can do a certificate course in normal, and they are also, otherwise, they are now accepted. So this kind of courses for both the categories are going to be available in future. On completion of this, you are going to earn whatever it is, a position, promotion, recruitment, service, and so on and so forth, provisions. So therefore, NP has a very good policy perspective and very sensitive and practical implementation. Of course, we have a challenges, but to have a thought idea, which put on a paper in a policy perspective has got. Interestingly, you see support for gifted students and students with special talents. The other category also it did not ignore. It also has said, encourage the gifted, talented students. How? You have project-based or clubs, science club, math club, language club, Olympiad and other competitions. Then efforts for interventions in rural areas and in regional language to ensure widespread participation. For example, now already we have like this, Navodaya schools, KVS, Kendriya Vidyalayas. Extensive use of technology to encourage talented and gifted children. NCERT, NCTE will develop guidelines for the education of gifted children. Then B.Ed. programs to allow specialization in education of gifted children. In future, it is going to come. Now, the 4 years, you are going to have this specialization also. So, a few more are there in general perspectives, but which I'm not going to discuss now. I'll just pass here. Should there be any context reference, taking it, we'll be discussing, but it's almost time for us to conclude. So I invite your questions once again, and these are any aspect of inclusive, integrated, differently abled learners and NPE 2020 perspective.
Sir, mera ek question hai.
Please.
What a teacher who are not trained from teaching differently abled student should do in teaching Divyang student of his class?
Yeah, definitely this is going to be one challenge, and also I would like to add on an opportunity. There are two things. Point one, even those who are trained are not going to meet all the needs. Wherever possible, they do at their level. At their level, it cannot be met, or the regular classroom setup will not permit. Still, they can be referred to either specialists or resource centers. So similarly, a teacher who has sensitivity, who is not having training, but is oriented, mentally set, have sensitivity, can examine and invite, discuss, refer. Now, to give you the best example is, all women and girls, before they attain their motherhood, are normal women, normal girls. And the moment they attain the motherhood, they get a lot many skills. Who taught them? To the best of my knowledge, there is no school under the sky which is teaching motherhood skills. But our mothers, because they have that attitude, they raise to the occasion and are meeting the needs of their children. Now, all these are our children. You call it motherhood, fatherhood, but rather preferred word is the teacherhood. Need to embrace. I'm not saying visually challenge, you go, you learn Braille and teach him. No, it's okay. It's totally visually challenged. We all know at least that word called Braille will be available. Otherwise, if I take my mobile and type, how can I help visually challenged? It gives 10 ways. Two only I can implement. The remaining 8, I will say these are available. You find out with whether your parents are interested, can come do this. Or otherwise you have NGOs. Or otherwise you report to the government authorities. You have visually challenged state level resource center, national level resource center, NIVH, National Institute for Visually Challenged kind of institutions. So I understand, because I'm saying with this good spirit, if I'm going to meet 100%. No, I'm not saying. Even I can't meet. I have done PhD in LD. I don't deal all LD children for myself because I'm not in that institutional setup. Basic learning difficulties children, I do counseling. When it goes, there is one something called AP Dyslexic Association. I refer them to that particular center. And interestingly, it so happened, I referred one candidate, and a particular day they have visited that. And that day I was the resource person there. So interestingly, and that parent asked me, sir, why did you refer us all the way here? We would have come to your place only. Then I said, I'm sorry. That place has its own limitation. And this is especially, today I'm there. Tomorrow, if you come, I will not be here, but somebody else will be here. Hope that makes sense in the context.
Sir, Sambhu sir ka ek question hai chat box mein.
Yeah.
Who should a teacher educator plan teaching strategy for teachers, for teacher learners? I mean, what should be the philosophy mindset of teacher educator?
Without much repetition, if I say teacherhood on similar lines of the motherhood, inclusive teacherhood, which is on the lines of the motherhood. So therefore, let us look at what can be done at our level. What are the resources available in and around of our locality? If so severely situation is there, where at state level or national level we can refer them, for which whether parental support is available, or do we need to seek another NGO support, or do we need to seek another governmental organization support? All this will come from that inclusive teacherhood.
अगर और किसी का क्वेश्चन है तो वो चैट बॉक्स में टाइप करें या अपने आप को अनम्यूट करके पूछे।
यस प्लीज। ऑल राइट, विद दिस फ्यू वर्ड्स, इफ देर आर नो मोर क्वेरीज एट द मोमेंट टू डिस्कस, and you can type on anyway WhatsApp group of our own working teacher internship group will be working. You can type in and also, and probably relevant. But I understand, before I conclude, let me thank the organizers for the opportunity given and providing us a good platform. And it's not that easy to implement, as said. Practically, there are challenges, there are limitations, there are crunch of resources. But a positive bent of mind, that inclusive teacherhood, is going to help us to gradually overcome all this and go a step forward in this direction, which is the need of the day. With these words, I thank you one and all for your patient listening and active participation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. मैं डॉक्टर सोमू सर को आमंत्रित करता हूं। सर, आप दो शब्द कहें। डॉक्टर सोमू सर टीचर एजुकेटर प्लेटफॉर्म असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एजुकेशन बीएचयू। नाउ यू आर वेलकम सर। यस सर ऑडिबल।
Yes sir, good evening sir. My name is Dr. Anuradha Nakka. I would like to ask you one question.
Dr. Anuradha, your voice was not clear, very much clear.
Yeah, yes, so we'll request her to type in the chat. We will go through it.
Please,
it's okay.
Please type your question in chat box, Dr. Anuradha. We will send your question to a resource person, and surely he will respond. Please. First of all, I personally and on behalf of our community of teacher educators express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Yakia P from Hyderabad. Sir, you accepted our invitation and given your valuable time for this important topic. I attended your this session from beginning. It is very useful and interactive session. You replied all queries of participants effectively. Sir, we will in contact in future. As and when we need, we will contact you. This is our unique initiative for needy students. This is national virtual live class. Teacher do not know students. Students do not know fellow students. Organizer did not know students and resource person before this session. We never met physically. But this online class is being organized effectively. It is because of you all, beautiful souls. I say again, beautiful souls, we are assembled here for a noble cause. I hope one request to all participants to please be active learner, suggest topics, attend our sessions, ask questions, because we want to make upcoming sessions need based. So at last, I also thank to our all coordinators of this online teacher education program, Mr. Shambhunath, Mr. Anand Sahu, and Ms. Jagriti Gupta. They are working, they are managing, they are organizing and conducting all these sessions successfully. And I hope all of you are member of our Facebook group, namely Teacher Educators _ SSS, means Teacher Educators for Social Service. SS denotes for social service, free of cost service. This is our central online platform for all members. All announcements and informations are being shared on our Facebook group. So please keep in touch with us, and we will meet in our next session. With these words, I invite Jagriti Gupta for formal vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes,
ma'am.
Vadakkam, namaste, good evening to one and all the participants in this virtual meet. As it is said, that best and the beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or touched. They must be felt by a deepest of heart. I consider my great privilege to present the vote of thanks to our respected resource person, sir. Yakya, sir, your dedication, commitment, courage, and the way you present your thoughts with us deserves the deepest gratitude. Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable thoughts with us in such a wonderful way. It was very enriching and fruitful session. Your focus was on Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. That was inclusive education. Adding to this, the whole PPT presentation comprises of various beautiful pictures that made the whole session very interesting and very fruitful. The session was in a simple language so that we can understood well, and the practical information has been shared with us in a very decent way. Adding to this, permitting the child to answer in the Urdu language was the awesome example of inclusive education, which is very practical. And one was that explaining motherhood makes a whole session connected with us on this occasion of Mother's Day. And the way you answered query of every participants, every attendees, gives a different insights to us in the field of differently abled and inclusive education. In the new education policy of NEP 2020, once again, on behalf of whole teacher educators community, thank you, sir, for giving such a wonderful deliberation and making the whole session successfully. But the session, the thanks, and the program was unsuccessful, can never be successfully completed without our respected and graceful personality, Dr. Somun Singh, sir, who's every time available to for us, who is everywhere, time stands for us, for their enriching us and in various means. Thank you, sir, for giving me this chance for acknowledgement of the session. And next is the special thanks to our coordinator, Sri Shambhunath, sir, Sri Anand Sahu, sir, for giving the whole session of whole idea of virtual webinar into reality, their technical expertise to real, very, very helpful to, for us. Last but not the least, our audience, our respected participants, associate professors, assistant professors, MPhil, MA, MEd, DLED students, and all the upcoming teacher educators. Your gracious presence is always solicited and gives us immense source of motivation for organizing such more enriching sessions in future. And once again, thank you for sparing your valuable time with us and listening us very patiently, listening us very actively. Thank you to one and all. Once again, stay safe in this very pandemic time. I end up my words with this. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Yakya, sir, once again.
Thank you, everybody.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Hello, sir. I have a doubt, sir.
Okay, fine. Go ahead.
Pratibha, I request you to please type your doubt in chat box or in our WhatsApp group. We will surely forward your doubt or question to Dr. Yakya, sir, and he will surely respond to you, because time is also a very important aspect.
All right, just please do type as sir suggest. I'll reply back.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you so much, sir.
So, I announced to sum up this session. So, you can left the meeting.
All right, then, taking leave of you, thank you once again, organizers, especially the coordinator, sir, and all the team.